Hello, my name is Margaret Srinivasan, and I work at the Jet Propulsion Lab in Pasadena, California. I'm the SWOT Deputy Program Associate for NASA Applied Sciences Program and the Altimetry Missions Applications Lead. My colleagues include members of the SWOT Applications Working Group and the Altimetry Applications Working Group, who constitute people from the science team, the projects, international partners, and university partners. So as the title of my talk suggests, the NASA has an observing system that can monitor Earth's surface water from space. I want to share with you how information about the ocean and water on land can lead to better management of this resource for society. I want to convey three things today. I want to introduce you to these missions. I want to describe a little bit about how they inform operational and practical applications. And I'll talk about how the data and information products, which are continuously monitor ocean and surface water bodies, are informing users. Tools we use to make these observations are a series of NASA satellites that are monitoring changes in Earth's surface water. The series of satellite missions was initially developed by NASA and CNES and the French Space Agency and includes other international partners and NOAA. These missions began in 1992 with Topex Poseidon and have been collecting a continuous series of ocean surface topography data for nearly 30 years with JSON 1 and JSON 2, and currently operating JSON 3, launched in 2016, and Sentinel-6 Michael Freilich, launched just a year ago. These missions will extend well into the next decade with launches of SWOT in a year from now and Sentinel-6B, which should launch in 2025. Sentinel-6 is the latest in a series of that which provide a global view of sea surface height anomaly data every 10 days. And it provides data as well on large rivers and lakes globally. The Surface Water and Ocean Topography Mission, or SWOT, will launch in 2022 and has an exciting new technology, a Ka-band interferometric radar that will collect data across a 120-kilometer wide swath with a gap in the center for nadir altimeter track. Globally, we will be taken both over the ocean and over freshwater areas. SWOT will see lakes which are at least 250 meters by 250 meters and rivers 100 meters wide or larger, and ocean features in the submesoscale under 100 kilometers down to tens of kilometers, where a lot of the heat exchange happens in the ocean. This is the first time we can measure these parameters from a single satellite. So SWOT will provide a much clearer view of these measurements, along with observations over rivers, lakes, and reservoirs and wetlands. It'll improve resolution from current missions, which provide about a quarter of a degree resolution down to a 20th of a degree resolution. This improvement in resolution will allow researchers and users to monitor changes in the ocean down to these scales of 15 kilometers compared to roughly 200 kilometers, which is possible with current mission technology. It'll also allow us to get closer to the coast, within a few kilometers of the coast. The image on the left is high tide flooding in North Carolina, and this happened just a few weeks ago, November 2021. You can see how vulnerable these homes are. The flooding event, which affected regions from Georgia up to New Jersey, was a result of a confluence of seasonal high tides and offshore winds. This was not a storm or a hurricane. Regional changes in sea level may exacerbate these events. In addition to monitoring sea level rise using ocean altimetry satellites, we can also monitor levels on large lakes and reservoirs around the globe. The image on the right is Lake Oroville in California, taken during the last major drought in 2015 in California. NASA and partners can monitor water levels on large lakes and rivers and have the capability to monitor vastly more surface water bodies beginning next year when SWOT launches. How can NASA help inform these challenges like flooding, sea level rise, water management, and impacts related to climate change? By continually monitoring global sea surface topography, sea level, for one. NASA has been working on these challenges for 30 years. Over time, this period, we have measured nearly 4 inches of global mean sea level rise. This rise comes largely from meltwater from ice sheets and mountain glaciers and from ocean heating. Not only are we measuring the rise of sea level, but our observations are showing that the rate of rise is increasing. The first 7 years of these missions, the rate was on the order of 2 millimeters per year. The next decade, it was roughly 3 millimeters per year, and now it's over 4 millimeters per year of sea level rise. This output is from a data analysis tool in the NASA's sea level portal, and it's available for all coastal areas around the U.S. at this point, and shows the relative sea level rise, which is sea level rise plus subsidence, since 1992 in New Orleans, where this meeting is happening, of about 4 inches over the past 27 years. NASA and partners will further inform critical societal applications by continuing to monitor water in the Earth's rivers and lakes. The image on the left illustrates the rivers in the SWOT River database in the U.S. globally. This is what SWOT is expected to see in the U.S., and maps like this exist for the entire world that has been mapped out. SWOT's expected to observe over 2 million kilometers of rivers globally. That's 1.2 million miles in 10 kilometer reaches. The graph on the right is a time series derived from altimetry mission data beginning in 1992. The colors are coded to the satellite mission measurements. This one's for Lake Superior, and this data has been available for the mission duration, and it's available for hundreds of lakes and reservoirs worldwide. And it's on the Foreign Agricultural Service, the USDA website. So assessing river dynamics in poorly instrumented regions is possible from the vantage point of space. Satellite observations can provide information about discharge, flooding, and extent over much of the globe. So what can we do with this information? These are some of the applications of satellite altimetry data: planning for coastal impacts of sea level rise, as I've mentioned, improved flood modeling, operational oceanography, transboundary water information sharing, weather and climate forecasting, water resources management, and decision support. I'm going to talk about a few of these applications in the time that I have today, and I invite you to visit the websites at the end of my talk or to contact me directly, and I'm happy to talk with you about this. So I know that most of you here have some level of awareness of the threat of sea level rise in coastal regions and the vulnerabilities of populations in coastal zones and estuaries. Coastal zones are significant population centers with more than 10% of the population globally living in coastal areas that are less than 10 meters above sea level. These vulnerabilities include sea level rise, this high tide flooding, as I mentioned, which is also illustrated here on the left with that picture, and the NOAA tide gauge graph, threats to coastal infrastructure, erosion, ecosystem deterioration. Of course, marshes and wetlands, for example, provide critical ecosystem services for coastal defenses of storms and are important habitats for key species. We hear a great deal about sea level rise, and projections of future sea level rise are critical for coastal planners and policymakers trying to understand and account for sea level impacts in their communities. The JASON series missions have been accomplishing this for nearly 30 years, as I said. With its high-resolution data products, SWOT will have the potential to provide key inputs for supporting real-time operational applications in the coastal zone. Within a few tens of kilometers from the coast, the new mapping capabilities provided by SWOT will improve knowledge of coastal tides, as well as smaller-scale circulation features that impact the coastal zone. Specific applications in this area may include storm surge modeling, sediment transport, water quality issues, high-resolution nearshore circulation models, and others. Maps of currents and eddies from ocean surface topography missions are used in commercial shipping, naval operations, and recreational boating to optimize routes, and for marine spill and debris tracking. So operational oceanography is a key benefit, a key application for these missions. This map in the middle is of the Deepwater Horizon oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico in 2010. Oil is entrained, as you can see, in the loop current, right there, observed with altimetry, which is the black arrows, and sea surface temperature, which is the color. Satellite altimetry data enabled large-scale spatial analysis of the oil spill and the opportunity to develop processing tools to describe future oil spills in near real time without the need to mobilize a ship and crew, for example. With more altimetry data, ocean models can provide better prediction of such events. These observations are being used to improve flood model and forecasting. Altimetry data is being used operationally to simulate river level dynamics, for example. This image on the right illustrates virtual gauging stations, those red dots, located where ground tracks from the JSON-2 satellite cross major tributaries of the Ganges-Brahmaputra river system. The location data is matched to the Bangladesh Flood Forecast and Warning Center forecasts for advanced flood warnings, and it results in extended forecasting lead times and provides advanced warning from a nominal 3 days to 5 days. SWOT data combined with other spatial observations, weather forecasting, and hydrological and hydraulic models of rivers will significantly contribute to improved flood forecasting systems. More accurate weather and climate forecasting is possible with these data. Altimetry missions support and SWOT will enable more accurate weather and climate forecasting, especially seasonally. The quality of weather and climate forecasting largely depends on numerical modeling that uses state of the ocean surface and hydrological conditions of catchment areas in their initial boundary conditions. This image on the left of the El Nino Southern Oscillation, or ENSO. Understanding the pattern and effects of cycles such as ENSO is one of the key potentials of altimetry for understanding climate related to the ocean. The image on the left shows sea surface height relative to normal ocean conditions, and sea surface height is an indicator of heat content of the ocean. The image on the right is tropical cyclone heat potential map. This is an old but nice example of altimetry, which is being used operationally by NOAA for assessing tropical cyclone heat potential, TCHP. The map on the right shows the track of Hurricane Katrina in the Gulf of Mexico during August of 2005, superimposed on this TCHP field derived from altimetry. The color of the circles indicates the storm category, and maximum wind speeds of Hurricane Katrina increased dramatically as the storm passed over the warm waters of the loop current in the Gulf. The storm evolved quickly from Category 3 to a Category 5 event in a matter of 9 hours as it drew heat from the loop current, which served as a heat engine, an intensity multiplier, if you will, for hurricane strength. So altimetry data will improve models on a changing distribution of heat in the ocean, and SWOT will do this at higher resolutions. There are two applications programs active for these missions, the Altimetry Applications Program for the JSON series, which is led by me and the mission scientists and mission science leads and collaborators from our international partners and from the project. And then the SWOT Early Adopters Program, which is our focus for SWOT applications right now. And that's directed by NASA Applied Sciences Program and is led by me and the SWOT applications leads, which includes Faisal Hossein from the University of Washington and our French colleagues, Nicholas Picot and Santiago Luque Pena. Benefit to the user communities for these programs is more accurate measurements, providing accurate measurements for their operational and practical applications, a large local to global spatial coverage, reliable time series, ease of use, including training. We do a bit of training, and societal benefit of their applications. The benefit to the project is the demonstration of value added for these NASA missions, promotion of applied uses of the mission data, expanding the user communities for these missions, and enhancing our international collaborations, and also expanding the capabilities for technologies as more users are finding different ways. So thank you for listening. I invite you to join our team. If you work on altimetry data or applications related to the JSON series missions, we have the Altimeter Applications Program. If you use data or may or can use data which SWOT will produce, we have the SWOT Early Adopters or the SWOT Applications Working Group. And I invite you to visit one of these websites and check out our program and contact me if you have any questions. Thanks so much.